Ever since I was little, I've been surrounded by video games. Growing up around a big brother that was 10 years older than me, and my dad that only sat in his room all day and played video games, it was kinda bound to happen. My first video game that I played and completed by myself was Pokemon Sapphire. I remember stealing my brother's game card and accidentally wiping his world, and then I saved over his file, and I have no idea how he didn't beat the crap out of me, but he ended up just letting me keep the game out of frustration, and I started off with a little Torchic named Princess, even though it was a boy. But I didn't know what the little boy gender sign meant. I was like 6 or 7, so... yeah, and after that, I went and set off into my own little Pokemon world. If you don't know a lot about Pokemon, which I literally have no idea, like, how you won it, like, are you living under a rock? I have no idea. I don't know. But let me give you a quick summary. Pokemon is a game series where you start off, as a young Pokemon trainer, a kid that travels to raise and train Pokemon to fight each other. And you catch Pokemon and train them. Pokemon are basically just animals with powers. Some can be cute, others cool, some just weird. But anyways, you go around with these said Pokemon and defeat gym leaders, which are powerful Pokemon trainers, and eventually the Elite Four, which are the top four Pokemon trainers. And you do the Elite Four after you find the one-of-a-rare-kind, super-powerful Pokemon called the Legendary. But anyways, back to the point. Once I started playing Pokemon, I couldn't put it down. I was even more interested in it, as well as watching Pokemon anime with my brother every single Saturday and Sunday. I'd play Pokemon Sapphire every day for hours, and the only time I'd ask my brother for help is when I couldn't capture Kyogre, which was the legendary Pokemon of the game. Most likely due to my overleveled Blaziken and my underleveled rest of the team, I remember being obsessed with my Delcatty, which is bad Pokemon, but she's cute, for one, along with my Torchic and my silly-looking Pelipper. But I couldn't stop playing. After beating Sapphire, I moved on to more Pokemon games, my favorites being Diamond, Moon, and X. X mostly because I could pet my Pokemon, I could customize. It was really cute. To this day, I still play Pokemon, even games as bland as Let's Go Eevee and Pikachu, but like, hello, Eevee is so cute, how could you resist not doing anything, and plus you can walk around with your Pokemon, which is really cool. Anyways, one thing that did really interest me through all the Pokemon games was that little scary part of the game. The abandoned ship in Sapphire, Lavender Town from Red and Blue, and then Let's Go Pikachu and Eevee, the old Chateau in Diamond, etc. I was already interested in horror games at that point, also due to my brother. The first game that I even watched as a whole was Resident Evil 4. The Resident Evil series is a group of survival horror series, starting up with the first entry, where you were introduced to Chris Redfield and Jill Valentine, members from a group of an elite task force named STARS. Chris and Jill are stranded in a massive mansion that is infested with zombies and other horrifying monsters, and Resident Evil was a very well-received critically, commercially, and is often credited for defining the survival horror genre. It has since been hailed as one of the greatest video games of all time. I stole that from After a few more Resident Evil games, we were finally introduced to Resident Evil 4. Resident Evil 4 went through countless concepts and changes, and the developers were in a panic, as if Resident Evil 4 didn't do well and sell well, the franchise would be shut down. Multiple games were made after being concepts of the game. These games were games such as Devil May Cry and Haunting Ground. And Haunting Ground is a mix of Clock Tower and Resident Evil 4, and there's even an Easter egg at the very front of the game for Resident Evil 4 when there's this, like, little secret appearance from Huey the Dog from the Clock Tower game, Haunting Ground, yeah, whatever. In the final version of Resident Evil 4, though, we were introduced to Leon Kennedy, a returning main character from Resident Evil 2. In Resident Evil 2, Leon had his first rough day as a cop as he enters his job in Raccoon City, just for it to be drowning in bloodthirsty zombies and mutants. Leon's mission now in Resident Evil 4, which takes place 6 years after Resident Evil 2, is to rescue Ashley Graham, the president's daughter. In order to save Ashley, Leon has to travel to a remote, grimy, and eerie little area in Spain. Here, Leon is met by a bloodthirsty and pissed-off villagers, like a bunch of them, that instantly try to kill him. But it's soon revealed that they are basically being brainwashed by Las Plagas, which is basically a zombie monster parasite thing, and then they are all pledged their lives to a cult named Los Illuminados, which is basically like the Illuminati, I guess, I don't know, and they support Las Plagas. Leon must continue on in his story after finally finding Ashley and having to find a way to escape with his life and hers as well. Resident Evil 2 has made it an entirely new world for modern-day video games, as it has abandoned the series stamp of having a fixed camera angle. Resident Evil 4 introduced the new game entirely, with an over-the-shoulder third-person shooter game. Many people thought it would lower the game's horror factor, as in its past games, you would never know what was behind you or that one scary-looking corner, but in Resident Evil 4, it utilized the new free camera to make it so you don't instantly know what's going to come up next. You could turn a corner and you'd basically see what Leon was seeing, even if it wasn't in first person. Then you'd crap your pants because you'd hear Dr. Salvador's chainsaw rev up, followed by him charging at you, trying to slice Leon's pretty little head up clean off, which is really gross. This new game's style reinvented the survival horror genre and started the third-person shooter action games trend. You can still see the influence today in these games, like Dead Space, Gears of War, Uncharted, Grand Theft Auto V, Mass Effect, The Last of Us, etc. Resident Evil 4 is the first game that comes to mind when people ask me what game I was first exposed to. I'd force my older brother to play it over and over again on our old and dusty PlayStation 2, and I was completely in love with Leon despite him, like, me being so young, but hello, everybody has their little crush when they're younger. And I also loved Ashley, even though she could get annoying at times. But Resident Evil 4 has a very strong place in my childhood. I'm super grateful for that. Recently, when Resident Evil 2 Remastered came out, I instantly bought it and played through Leon's route. I would insert a bunch of clips of me streaming it, but you couldn't really watch more than two clips without me F-bombing after screaming my ass off and almost crying. Resident Evil 2's remastered version gives me the same playstyle as 4, despite the original Resident Evil 2 being played in the fixed camera angle I was talking about earlier. Resident Evil 2 is one of the scariest games I've played to this day, the remastered version, and it makes you anxious and you never know what's gonna happen. Even if you have played the original, they change stuff up. The scariest part of the game is definitely going to be this dude named Mr. X. He's a tyrant that literally follows you and tries to kill you for the entirety, like not even the entirety, like 90% of the game. He just follows you around, you can hear his footsteps above you, and he's just scary as hell. But many of the Resident Evil games following 4 took a dive for the worst. They tried to bring only the aspect into the new, or the action aspect into the newer games over the horror aspect, making the games feel like a bland and tiring version of Call of Duty. The Resident Evil franchise didn't make its comeback until Resident Evil 7, in my opinion, which was released back in 2017, and then the Resident Evil 2 Remastered followed it. I don't want to go straight into detail, but Resident Evil 7 is exactly what the franchise needed. It felt like a mix of Silent Hill and Resident Evil, which was an amazing feeling after going so many years without a genuinely good Resident Evil game. But what does Resident Evil and Pokemon really have to do in common with most of these things? Well, not really much. I mean, I'm going to introduce you now to my favorite middle ground between both of these games. Horror games that have a cute, likable characters, and more of an anime-ish art style, I suppose, also accompanied by how Pokemon games are mostly pixelated up until X and Y. RPG Maker horror games have been extremely important to me ever since I moved around in I found them in 2012. My introduction to this genre was a short but sweet game called Eve. After Eve, I moved into other games like The Witch's House, which is really good play, Mad Father, Masao, Corpse Party, etc. These games made the perfect little middle ground for me and are a perfect mix of super scary and edgy, and cute, I guess, like me, I don't know, more of the edgy part. I've talked for a while now though, so I'm gonna start shutting up. Please try out some of these games. 99% of RPG horror games are free, and they're pretty short. Just be prepared for your jump scares, and there's some gore, especially in Corpse Party. But that's pretty much it for now. Thanks for listening to me talk about stuff I really like for so long, and sorry if it's a little over my time limit, but ha, okay, bye.
To hear it, listen. X gon' give it to you. Wait for you to get it on your own. X gon' deliver to you. Knock, knock, open up the door, it's real. With the non-stop pop out from stainless steel.